Go ahead and get started. In some respects, we've saved the most important part of the program for after lunch. So hopefully you haven't eaten so much that you're going to doze or something through this afternoon. And I appreciate the town of Normal again. Mark Peterson has been around me long enough that if you don't have cookies after something, well, you know that the lunch is not quite complete. So appreciate him having some cookies available too. Sometimes you wonder, just how important is this really? Is it, maybe it's not urgent, or maybe there are other things I could do with my time. And this was passed on to me earlier about from a fellow who was the past president of the National League of Cities, so former council member or mayor, but it just brings home, I think, the importance a little bit. I just thought I'd read this, a little bit of this real quickly. Spent a couple of days in Charleston, West Virginia, and the water issue is still a big part of life in our capital city. Frightening, really. Bottled water everywhere, much discussion about water. Had the opportunity to talk to the mayor, Danny Jones, about how they're dealing with this event. No city should have to go through this. Millions of dollars in lost revenue, gut shot to the image of the city and our state. This will be a decades-long rebuilding of image and trust. We cannot treat our rivers and streams as a dumping ground for chemicals. And just when you thought you'd heard everything, an accident caused diesel fuel to leak into the river and was creating a sheen on the river. I hope that our legislators take this seriously, but that is a question that is not yet answered. As I drove out of town, I passed the Freedom Industries tanks, and the puny containment area around the tanks is almost laughable. We have to do better. A little further out of town, I stopped for coffee and sat and watched as people pulled up, filled gallon jugs with water from a large silver tanker truck. It felt like a third world country. And, we take water for granted here. We're blessed in so many ways. And we turn on the tap, and the water people do a great job of providing the pressure and the quality, and we have such great quality water to begin with. And it's just so easy for all of us to sit back and think, well, this is the way it's going to be forever. But as we can learn from places like Charleston, West Virginia, that isn't necessarily the case. If we're not vigilant and working together to make sure that our future includes clean water, why, then shame on us. So this afternoon, we have two things we want to do. One is a citizen advocacy panel, and then Mark Peterson will have some closing remarks as well. On the panel, we have John Marlin. John's an environmentalist, a long-standing environmentalist, and maybe we're on the same side of issues when I was the city manager most of the time, not necessarily all the time, but we always respected John because he is very knowledgeable and always had important things to say. And most importantly, John was the chair of the Illinois Pollution Control Board for several years as well, so not only personally is he an environmentalist, but he's had just terrific experience at a state level. And if only he were the chair of the Pollution Control Board today, we would be in better shape. Steve Bridges, one of those citizens on the ground in the Clinton area, and is one of the leaders trying to pull together more of a regional citizens group, Mahomet Aquifer Protection Alliance, really recognizing the aquifer impacts a lot of folks across a lot of different jurisdictions, and if we're going to be successful, it's going to take more than the people immediately around the landfill to be successful. And Angelo Caparellan, who's a local folks here and very active environmentalist as well, and I met Angelo at the Clinton event that we did several months ago as well, and got to hear some of his passion for our topic as well. So those are the folks that are going to address us and talk about, okay, we have all this information now what do I do with it? What can we do to try to make sure that there's a successful outcome here?
Well, good afternoon. I'm glad to see we got most of our people back. In the 1970s and early 80s, was a field organizer on conservation issues mainly related to water resources, and most specifically the Oakley Dam at Decatur and the Lincoln Dam at Charleston, both of which were proposed at the time. So I'm going to give a modification of a talk I gave in 20-some states back in the 70s to people who were trying to organize against federal bureaucracy, trying to take their farms and their landscape and turn it into waters and reservoirs. So I'll tell you what I told them back then, and I had no idea what the other speakers were going to talk about. Nothing was coordinated, so if you see some coincidences, they're purely coincidental, although they might be happy coincidences. So I'm going to give examples. Some of these will be useful to your efforts, some you've already done, and some won't be useful at all. So just pick and choose, it's like a smorgasbord. And I also am retired, although I think of it more as retreaded, in that I'm still quite active. And I've known George Roadcap and Al Wehrman for over 20 years. I worked with a sister agency of theirs at the university. And if they're concerned about the aquifer, you should be too. So we're going to give some thoughts on organizing. And as usual, things could be worse. This is a picture that was taken in the 50s of disposal of liquid hazardous waste. They basically dug a pit somewhere or went to a gravel pit. And it's hard to tell because of the quality of this picture, but what you see here is liquid waste coming out of the back of tanker trucks directly into a hole. Another thing that was very prevalent back in the earlier days of waste disposal was just putting stuff in 55-gallon drums and sometimes burying them, but often just leaving them in an office building or a warehouse or dumped in the desert somewhere or on somebody's farm. Today we have liners, we have regulations, and landfill facilities are engineered. And they're engineered to leak slowly. You've heard many people speak about how these chemicals, if they get away, they might take a long, long time to get from point A to point B, down to the aquifer and across to whoever's well you're worried about. Well, a lot of those estimates are based on the assumption that everything will work perfectly. And in my experience at the Pollution Control Board, we learned that very frequently the worst environmental accidents, disasters, or whatever you want to call them, were basically caused by operator error, deliberate circumventing the regulations or rules or operating manual to save money, falling asleep on the job, or any number of other things. So when you're putting out a liner like this, if it gets punctured or the seam isn't perfect, you can have a leak much quicker than would normally be expected. So anyway, that's just one issue. The other is when you're dealing with modern landfills and almost anything else, you're dependent not only on the goodwill of the operator, but the honesty of the person bringing waste to the facility. They may say they have bundles of municipal waste, but if you cut them open, you might find liquid hazardous waste in containers in the middle of the bundle. So you never really know what's coming on the truck or the train. The other thing I should mention before getting into the regular organizing is that a lot of the regulatory and other issues surrounding chemical waste is phrased in terms of PCBs or TCE or dimethyl death or some specific chemical. And like taking drugs and putting them in your own body, it's often not the individual drug that's the problem, it's the combination. So although PCBs are not very soluble in water, if you get them mixed up with a certain solvent that is soluble in water, and they have an affinity for each other, they can move very quickly as opposed to just very slowly moving a millimeter or so a year. So those of you who've heard Bruce Hannon talk know he's fascinated by triangles. Well, we use triangles a lot. I don't think you've seen this one if you saw Bruce's talk. This is a picture of the handheld prop I used in the 70s to talk to farmers and conservationists about how the proponents of a dam, a levee, a landfill, or any other facility seeking approval are organized. They're like peas in a pod in the sense that they're all going to gain something and they're coordinated enough to operate in unison. and have all of their energies focused on the key politician, bureaucratic agency, or other entity that has to be convinced in order to get their project going. Another triangle, which I'm sure Bruce has shared with you, I don't know really who came up with this. Bruce and I thought we did, but I've seen it in many books over the years, so maybe we got copied and maybe we independently invented something somebody else did. But basically, your typical project, particularly something involving Congress, has three corners. I can't quite see if that's showing over there. Okay, well, it's not, I can't see it, so I may not use it. But anyway, at the top is a political interest. In the case of the Oakley Reservoir, which I cut my teeth on, it was Congress. The politicians were in favor of the dam primarily because they thought they were going to get votes and contributions. And in the 60s and 50s, that was largely true. You have economic interests. We usually just characterize them as the Chamber of Commerce. No offense to the Chamber. They're just known as an economic interest group. But there's somebody that's going to benefit economically involved with the project. It can be a private company or some other entities we'll get into in a minute. And then there is what we used to call a bureaucratic interest. In our case, it was the Corps of Engineers, whose bureaucracy was dependent on keeping the public and the politicians in favor of spending federal money, pouring concrete into rivers, or building levees, or doing something like that so that they can keep their jobs going. Proponents almost always have something to gain. It can be votes, it can be money, it can be funding status within agencies. You know, your status in the federal and state government often depends on your agency budget and your closeness to the governor. Land speculators and developers frequently show up in projects. Taxing bodies may or may not benefit. For example, a nuclear power plant can be a windfall for a school district, and maybe it's not so good for some other people, but if it increases your tax base, it can be something you might seek. There are also regional entities. Now, in the case of this landfill, it's rather apparent that people who have PCBs and other chemicals in their backyard in a 10-state area or more are likely to benefit if the Clinton landfill is one of only 10 places in the country that can accept PCB wastes. So you've got people who want to pass a problem from their area anywhere else. And if it happens to be Clinton, that's just part of the game. Various contractors and consultants benefit a lot from these battles. But the bottom line is, the proponents often are set to realize a large tangible benefit that makes them easy to mobilize. It was very difficult for us to fight levee expansions because you have a very few landowners behind a levee in most cases. They're going to reap a tremendous financial benefit when the federal government spends millions of dollars to take their land from frequent floodplain to flooding once in 100 years. Those people are very tight-knit, they're organized, and they put pressure on Congress. The rest of the public will probably never hear the levy, and it might cost them 1 or 2 cents out of their federal tax dollar to get the levy built for somebody else. Here's how the opponents of a project are often organized. And this has probably been a relevant triangle since time began. Because when we used to talk about it, we'd say something like, here you've got the Sierra Club, and here's the County Farm Bureau, and here's Joe's Hardware Store, and here's a school district, and here's this interest group, and that. The problem is, the opponents to a project are scattered around, and you've heard a lot of talk today about how people who've been interested in this issue for many years are trying to pull together. I can assure you, if you're fighting an entity that is going to benefit a multi-state region, there are huge economic interests who you need to organize against. And you may not even know who they are, but the idea would be to get yourselves organized and aligned so that your efforts are focused in basically the same direction and that your story is straight. We don't want 20 different explanations of why doing this project is important. They're all useful as subunits of why it's important, but the bottom line should be a clear focus, and it should be aimed at whoever is making the decision at the moment. The people who have something at risk, as was pointed out earlier, often don't know what they have is at risk. If the case of the water supply, most people don't know where their water comes from. They don't care until it's gone. And if you look at the last bullet here, there was a song, "You Don't Know What You've Got Till It's Gone." That applies to many of these projects I dealt with in the 70s. People lose their river valley when it's turned into a reservoir. If you lose your water supply, has been pointed out, it's game over. Frequently, the people who are either bystanders or should be opposed but are being quiet, they don't see a great personal risk. They don't have much tax money involved. Things look like they're a long term. People who get excited about things are those who are going to recognize they're going to lose something like a favorite hunting or fishing ground. They're going to lose some peace of mind, or the rural character of an area was an important thing, especially in the Virginias. When big projects were going to come in, the people were quite concerned that they would lose the rural culture that had nourished them for many centuries. One other thing that should be mentioned, people have talked about their grandkids. Well, I started out as a undergraduate student working against Oakley Dam in 1971. The planning horizon was 50 years. That was 2020. I'm almost there, you know? And if my neighbors are any example and I live to be 90, I've got another 35 years to go. So about the time I turned 35, I stopped talking to people about saving something for their grandkids. And I said, why don't you think about saving this not only for your grandkids, but having it there so you can enjoy it in your old age? Okay, another point to think about. When someone gets something for nothing, the rest of us get nothing for something. That applies to many federal boondoggles, state boondoggles, et cetera. So if somebody's happy as a clam because they're getting a benefit from a state bureaucracy or a federal bureaucracy or Congress, just remember, somebody else is going to pay the price, whether it's a monetary price or quality of life price. What really matters in life? Well, aside from family, the three most basic things I can think of are air, water, and soil. Now, people in China are learning a lot about air that we and Western Europe learned about 1890. But the most important thing on this list is probably water, because it takes a whole lot of effort to get the air so polluted you're going to die tomorrow. It doesn't take much effort to get yourself into a water situation where you're in dire straits tomorrow. And we have a tremendous vulnerability in this country in the way we're treating our water. But things are delicate and fragile enough without putting a toxic landfill over it. And oil, we all talk about oil, but oil is not nearly as valuable as soil and water. How do we get where we are today? Well, to revert to landfills for a minute, landfills have always been a place where you throw something you don't want, or it's a place you go to the bathroom when you leave your teepee. But anyway, the bottom line is landfills were often built on poor ground, or mined out areas, or floodplains. After we started permitting landfills, permits became harder and harder to obtain. So frequently, existing municipal landfills or open dumps sought permits and got converted into landfills at the same site, which was often a very geologically poor site. So anyway, we've got a lot of landfills in the country that keep trying to upgrade and change their permit. And key questions that surround that sort of thing are such things as, okay, if a landfill gets permitted, if it gets a revised permit, can the current owner sell it and the new owner keep all the permits? And whereas you might like Uncle Joe, who's your current landfill operator, if Uncle Joe sells it to the purveyors of dimethyl death, you may not have any control. Chemical waste must be dealt with. And as I've said before, other people in places who have the hazardous waste now, they just want to get rid of it. But if we were starting to look for a PCB facility today from scratch, we would have the geologists look for a suitable site. We'd have a better, safer area for it, and there'd be a whole lot more testing, and we'd also be considering other alternatives rather than burying the waste. There are other things you can do with it. I never talked to Joel about this, but he said some of my talk this morning. What's legal is not necessarily moral or reasonable. And an action that appears to be legal, or who some high-priced lawyer says is legal, may suffer from misinterpretation or erroneous application of the law or regulation. In other words, don't believe what the opposition lawyer says. I don't think we need to expand upon that very much. Because just because somebody says it's legal doesn't mean it is. And the corollary to that is that the laws can change. Many times a legal battle is lost and the party who loses goes to the legislature and changes the law. Sometimes it can be retroactive, sometimes it can't. So what I always tell my associates who have a problem is, it's not enough to win your legal battle. You need also to win your political battle and get the laws set up so that the public interest is protected. Now we're going to talk a little bit about some other things here. An important thing to consider is intimidation and deference. Now, I was talking to a bunch of farmers in North Dakota once and asked them how they handled the Corps of Engineer public hearing, and they said, well, we were scared to death. When we were in Europe in the Army, we were privates and colonels were big shots, and you don't talk back to a colonel. That's one of the reasons the Corps of Engineers uses colonels and generals, is a lot of the public is intimidated by an authority figure. Well, you can't let yourself be intimidated by authority figures who are trampling on your rights. It's about that simple. This is a slide that was made back in the dam days. The Stop the Dam sign would be in the hands of people like me back in those days. But just be aware that status, titles, and offices can be and often are abused upon occasion. You don't want to defer to one political or economic body if your legitimate interests are threatened by what they propose in their own jurisdiction. Now, you've heard today how the DeWitt County Board was probably outgunned. They didn't have a lot of money. They don't have a lot of staff. But you still can't let an ill-informed decision determine the future of a region. And I know politicians defer to each other in city council. You don't want to do something that affects somebody else's ward, or if you're in the state legislature, you want to defer to somebody else's district interests. But sometimes there's a regional interest or a national interest, and you can't defer to the lowest body or the next door senator, even though that senator might vote against something you want some other day, and that's how they kind of keep each other in line. But the bottom line is, don't be intimidated and don't defer without a good reason. It's perfectly reasonable to defer to another body of equivalency on something that doesn't matter really to your own region's interests. But if it does matter, don't defer. You've got to gather your own facts and take a reasonable stand to protect your community interests and demand that agencies and politicians protect the interests of the public. Now, how do you go about getting their attention? Well, one thing you can do is you can do a petition. Now, this is a petition back before the internet existed, and if the internet and all those whiz-bang things existed back then like they do now, we would have had a lot more fun doing what we did. But here is a hand-delivered petition with over 65,000 signatures on it. That's Bruce Hannon in the middle, about 40-some years ago, that was circulated statewide to protect Allerton Park from the Oakley Dam at Decatur. We kept an eye on our politicians. We had Senator Percy, Senator Stevenson, Governor Ogilvy, Governor Kerner, and a variety of others all in favor of this dam, along with most of the congressional delegation in Illinois. And I'll mention that when I say we, I'm talking about the committee in Allerton Park. They started about 1966. I got involved in 71. So there's a long history there. But the we refers to the collective effort. Senator Percy gave the impression to different letter writers that he was on both sides of the issue. Were we going to let him get away with that? No. The letters were both published in as many local newspapers as could be, one talking about how much in favor of the dam he was, the other about how much interest he was in alternatives. As has been pointed out, this is not a political issue. When I worked the water projects, Republicans and Democrats joined with us when it was in their political interest. We fought with them when it wasn't. We rewarded our friends and we tweaked our enemies. Here's a poster that, this is a bumper sticker that we put out in 1976 favoring Democrat President Carter and Republican governor nominee Jim Thompson here in Illinois, because they were both very good on conservation issues, particularly our dam issues. So we rewarded them, whereas we poked Senator Percy. We didn't kill, we just tweaked. There's a reason for that. Some things to remember when you're trying to get organized is you want to mobilize your friends. And in this case, your friends should be anybody who's part of the Mahomet Aquifer Water Drinkers Association, as well as a lot of other people who have an interest in groundwater protection and environmental protection generally, and honesty on the part of our bureaucrats and politicians. So you seek allies, talk to your friends, and get them involved. You want to grant your opponents a reasonable amount of respect. They do have a position. It may be based on something pecuniary, but often there's other things. I mean, a lot of the people in favor of PCB landfills in somebody else's backyard want to get them out of their own backyard. So, but you want to pick apart their fallacies and try and find the truth and shine a light on the facts. A lot of people make up their lies and call them to the truth. So you've got to do the best you can. Everything you say isn't going to be a truthful statement, but make sure it's not your fault if it isn't. Don't underestimate your opponents or the power of public opinion. They both matter a lot. When we started fighting Oakley Dam, it was thought to be a lost cause. The entire political structure of the United States Congress, the Corps of Engineers, and local politics was against us. But we worked it. Bruce started in 66. By 1975, we had the dam unfunded. And by 1982, we had it bureaucratically killed. That dam changed my entire life. Not only did I meet my wife on the picket line trying to save Allerton Park, but it changed me from an academic course that was going to make me a entomologist teacher somewhere at a professorship to somewhat of an activist. So those things happen. Don't burn wooden bridges. By that I mean, if you burn a wooden bridge, you burn the deck, the structure, and most importantly, the foundation structure. Remember, somebody who's your enemy today might be your friend tomorrow, and we'll come back to Senator Percy on that one. So if you want to burn something, don't burn the whole bridge. Leave enough that you can get back to that person or that entity in the future. Some insights from our past battles. Divergent groups, think again of that mixed up triangle. You all here are a pretty diverse group. You've got many counties, you've got all kinds of educational and economic backgrounds, but you've got a common purpose. What we did with the dam fights all over the Midwest, and I helped organize in over 20 states, was we went into an area and got the potential opponents together into a room and sat down with them and went through what the interests were. One group, I remember in Charleston, we were bringing together such diverse groups as the NFO and the Farm Bureau and the League of Women Voters and the Student Environmental Group, most of whom didn't know each other. So we all met at the left tail light of our car in Hardy's parking lot. That's how we found each other. Whoever's at the left tail light was presumed to be a potential friend. But we put together diverse groups. In the Oakley Dam group, we had the John Birch Society. Anybody old enough to remember the John Birch Society? They're like Tea Party. The Macon County and several other counties' John Birch Societies would go to Washington with us to testify against Oakley Dam and Lincoln Dam and the Crawfordsville Dam, et cetera. We had the Farm Bureau and the NFO together. And if you know anything about farming, that's an oil and water mixture. They came to our meetings. They testified in unison on our behalf, their own behalf, actually. So you put together divergent groups, and here you can see a headline from 1973 talking about that. Senator Percy started cold feet on the dam about 1973. he asked the General Accounting Office to do an economic evaluation of the reservoir. And of course, the study came back finding discrepancies in the economics of the Oakley Reservoir, and Senator Percy used that as his hook to withdraw support. We had been very firm with the senator, calling him on everything we thought he did wrong, but we were always reasonably polite about it, to the point where when he finally decided we were going to win, he made sure that the arrow that got the dam first had his name on it. And he called me one morning. He woke me up at 8 o'clock in the morning. I was a graduate student sleeping on a mattress, and the phone rang on Saturday morning at 8, which you don't do to students. It was Senator Percy telling me he was going to kill Oakley Dam, and he wanted me to know first. And I was just happy as a clam. So anyway, it's a good example of don't burn the whole bridge, because he was very much against us to the point where when I started out, he forbid his staff to even talk to me. A few years later, they were letting me into the inner office in Washington, those doors that never have a name on them. So you bide your time. And here we have the major lineup when the dam finally got killed in 1975, Senator Stevenson, Governor Walker, and Senator Percy, who had been some of the dam's strongest supporters 3 years before, are lined up taking credit for killing it and trying to find an alternative. Another thing we did that was very important is we put most of our information into a couple documents. Battle for the Sangamon is a compilation of all the reasons we thought Oakley Dam was a bad idea. Chapters were authored by different professors at the university. I ghost wrote some of them, but I was the editor. It's a 108-page book. It made our testimony to Congress, and we took this to Congress over, this went through three printings, about 5,000 copies. It became kind of the go-to book, or the Bible, if you will, for how to fight a dam back in the 70s. We also put our arguments about water supply into a newspaper that we hand-delivered all over Decatur one day with the help of the local chapter of the John Birch Society. Now, a lot of people start their battles with a local slogan. We made the same mistake. We always talked about Save Allerton Park, which meant something in Champaign and Piatt County, but meant very little in Chicago until we got all four newspapers up there to endorse our position. And when we were doing this, there were dams all over the country. So I got a bright idea, and I printed 50,000 of these. And we circulated them all over the United States of America. And if you were in Maine, you saw this bumper sticker, you thought it was Dickey Lincoln Dam. In California, it was Auburn. In Nebraska, it was Narrows. In Missouri, it was Merrimack. And it was a very good tactic. Now, we did a lot of politicizing in those days, and we took about 60 farmers from Piatt and Macon County to the Capitol one day. And among other things, we got an audience with the governor's chief of staff. These two farmers are sitting in the governor's office listening to the governor's top aide tell them why it's okay to flood their farms to build Oakley Dam, to provide flood control for farmers downstream. They could take a pitchfork into the Capitol back then and nobody cared. But notice, they put our bumper sticker on the pitchfork. Anybody remember Kent State, the girl kneeling over the dead students? The same photographer who took that picture took this picture. It is not posed, it's an actual picture. I had to pay Associated Press $75 to get the rights to use that picture on a poster. We printed about 1,000 of these. They were all over the country. And most importantly, they made the AP wire because it was an AP photographer, and over 50 daily newspapers in the United States of America carried this picture with a caption about Oakley Dam. It did us a tremendous amount of good. Those posters currently have been bringing as much as $400 at fundraisers. Here you see some of those posters in action with Governor Walker surrounded. Another thing that we found useful that you could do is gather up information on disasters associated with leaking landfills, failed engineering containments, be they oil things on the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico, or moonshots that went, or actually the Mars shot went awry because one set of bureaucrats was using the metric system, the other was using the English system. And You can find lots of things. We went all over the country and got information on where flood control dams had screwed up big time. And we let people all over the Midwest know what could happen. Here's another example of engineering excellence. This is a very expensive flush toilet outhouse at Lake Shelbyville. The Corps of Engineers put it in after EPA decided that the drop seat outhouses were not acceptable anymore. Of course, they built it in the flood pool. So just about every year, for 5 years running, the campgrounds at Lake Shelbyville flooded, and I had this little girl stand there like she needed to go, and we had a saying, you can get to Lake Shelbyville, but you can't go there. That joke was a big hit all over the country, I can assure you. Now, here's another thing. This goes to the geology of your landfill situation. The geology is wrong where this landfill is located. The geologist will almost to a person tell you that. I can tell you with certainty that the geology where Carlisle Dam and Shelbyville Dam went is wrong. Where Oakley was going to go, it's wrong. Where Hunter Lake might go someday if they're really stupid over there is wrong. That's my future wife at the time standing there at the bottom of the cliff at Eldon Hazlett State Park on Lake Carlisle. That's supposed to be the beautiful shoreline of the lake. The problem is the soils cannot withstand the fluctuating water levels and the waves that are generated by wind. The state of Illinois put up signs that said, warning, danger, caving bank, so people would keep their kids away from the edge. The Corps of Engineers had an engineered solution. You'll probably hear a lot about retrofitting landfills. They put riprap all along the shoreline that was steep. Now, of course, they put the riprap high enough so that low water, it's undermined from the bottom, and at high water, it's undermined from the top. So what did the state of Illinois do? They put up signs now at the cliff that said, warning, danger, keep away from stone. Now, I use this as an example of why you should be cautious of experts telling you that they have an engineered solution. Now, when we fought with the Corps of Engineers, one of the big arguments we had was, why should the people behind a levee get all this increased value to their land without paying a dime? And why should the barge companies run up and down the Mississippi River that costs us X hundred million dollars a year to maintain for free when the public at large has to pay $350 a night to camp at a Corps of Engineer reservoir? And this particular slide was a major player in Jimmy Carter getting his 6 cents a gallon barge fuel tax through. Again, these are just examples of the way you can think if you're trying to organize. When we fought the big trucks, so those of you may remember back about 1982, the truckers wanted to go to 80,000 pounds. They wanted doubles to run everywhere. Well, I've got a whole series on the trucking size and weight issue, but this is a bottom line. Sometimes you have to scare people with what could be. Now, I could have told people in the legislatures that there was a chance there would be 7 trailer trucks. But the trucking industry was actually experimenting with them, and one of our friends snuck into their facility and took this picture of 7 trailers behind 1 tractor. Actually, the biggest ones we have in the country now are 3, but if you've been on the roads around here behind a double during a snowstorm or a rainstorm, you know you got problems. Another thing that was hard to get across, all these technical issues are hard to get nailed down to something simple, but here's a map I put together by putting red ink on a Corps of Engineer map. All those red dots are proposed major dams like Lake Shelbyville in the upper Mississippi Basin. It's hard to explain that, but in Kentucky, Ohio, and Chicago, somebody decided in the cartoon department to just make an outline of the state, put a dam around it, fill it with water, and that's the Corps of Engineers plan. And this was adopted all over the country. You can take slogans. Those of you who go back to the Vietnam era remember this, make love, not war. Well, we made a slight editorial change in it, and this particular sign was very popular. I think it's still in my basement. But you can do this many ways. I noticed you've already done some of that with the aquifer bumper sticker, whatever it is, drip my reservoir, my aquifer. Or is that a chocolate kiss? I can't quite tell, but that's a very good adaptation. So don't be afraid to play around a little bit with terms. Like, I grow woodland wildflowers, and people ask me how you know they're ripe, and I say, do the Charmin test. And they say, what's that? But some of you here know what Charmin was and Mr. Whipple. Well, you don't squeeze the charbon, but if you squeeze your plant pod and it pops, it's ripe. So some people still know that. But anyway, my point here is find something the public knows and identifies with and twist it or adapt it to your needs. And a key thing to remember is, unlike a river, which flows fast, and those people in West Virginia who lost their water supply, they were in a real panic, but it only lasted about a week, and the problem went on downstream and became a problem in the ocean somewhere. But what goes in the aquifer stays in the aquifer. It's very, very hard to clean up groundwater. It flows slowly. It's hard to get out. It's almost impossible to clean once it's contaminated. So you might play around with slogans like that. This isn't the best possible combination on the what stays in Vegas goes to Vegas or whatever, but it's something to think about. So those are some ideas on organizing. They worked well for somebody somewhere back when we were active in that arena. So take what's useful and ignore the rest. So.
Pardon us while we try to get some technical issues clarified here. Hi, my name is Steve Bridges. I am from DeWitt County. I'm a parent. I'm also a volunteer with the Mahomet Aquifer Protection Alliance, which is a fairly new organization that got started late last year as a result of a need for a more regional group to focus on the Mahomet Aquifer and protecting that great resource. We do have a website, it's mahometaquifer.org. And the reason why I got involved in protecting the aquifer is because of this. This is my well at home. It does extend down into the Mahomet Aquifer, and my family drinks from it every day. And this is my children's school in Clinton, and their school is only 2 miles downwind from this. This is the chemical waste landfill, also known as the chemical waste unit. As you can see, it's currently active and it's taking in chemical waste as we speak. When they drilled my well, I really took for granted when the gentleman told me that by going into the aquifer, the Mahomet Aquifer, I was going to have an unending source of clean, clear water. He said it was the best source of water in central Illinois, and I would never have to worry about running out of water. And as you can see, the aquifer, as Al shown us early, that it extends clear from the Indiana border over to the Illinois River. And you can see the Clinton landfill is located smack dab right in the middle of it. You couldn't pick a worse place to put a chemical waste landfill if you were going to site it over this aquifer. A few years ago, a study was done on the Mahomet Aquifer, and some of the comments that came out of that was it said that in its purity, the Mahomet Aquifer surpasses nearly every water source in Illinois and beyond, and to find cleaner water, you'd have to melt ice from deep within an Arctic glacier. Nearly half of the states, for that matter, the nation's population, depends on groundwater for its drinking water, and in rural areas, that figure climbs to more than 90%. And most of us around here, even the small cities, fall into that rural category. A UN study said that around 30% of the world's fresh water is stored underground, but that constitutes about 97% of all fresh water that's potentially available for human use. So as we have found through the recent droughts that we've had, our surface sources of water are not adequate or reliable. We have tapped out all that we can out of our surface impoundments. And so we are relying more and more on subsurface resources for drinking water. I think the city of Decatur just announced that they're going to spend about $89 million to dredge Lake Decatur, and that will only increase their capacity by 30%. And as we know around here, lakes just fill back in. So our lakes are not the solution for long-term water use. And so we do have to rely on the Mahomet Aquifer as our only source of drinking water. So how in the world did this ever become a reality in central Illinois? As Joe mentioned earlier, we have a procedure for application of siting. And this is according to the Illinois EPA. It's during this local siting process that issues such as quality of life are considered. Unfortunately, I think any time there's a decision made by the Illinois EPA or any EPA, quality of life issues should always be considered. But unfortunately, in this process of landfills, it's only during the local siting that these quality of life issues are considered. And so DeWitt County did go through that in 2002. Part of the siting process requires a public hearing, which took place in July of 2002. And part of that public hearing is describing what they call an operating plan. The operating plan describes what kind of waste you're going to bring into your landfill and what kind of waste you will not bring into your landfill. And the landfill, this was a testimony that was given by Ron Edwards. This was the number two man at PDC Clinton Landfill. He was the vice president in charge of landfill development, so he was their expert on landfills. And this was his testimony. They asked what kind of waste will not be accepted at this landfill, and he testified under oath that waste containing PCBs regulated by the Toxic Substances Control Act will not be accepted. Later on in the testimony, he's addressing what these special wastes are. We heard about special waste. It's kind of this fuzzy category that things that aren't municipal waste but aren't technically hazardous waste. Now, they can be incredibly hazardous, incredibly toxic, but they're still considered special waste. And so here he's explaining what these special wastes are. And again, he says they must not contain a listed hazardous waste or PCBs in concentrations regulated by the Toxic Substances Control Act. So we should be okay, right? Well, this in 2011, the DeWitt County Board held a special board meeting. This was a public open meeting, and they did a tour of the chemical waste unit. And the public was open to ask questions. And this was a question I posed to Chris Coulter. This is the gentleman in the red shirt. Chris Coulter is the son of Royal Coulter, who is the head of the Coulter family. The Coulter family owns Peoria Disposal, Area Disposal, Clinton Landfill. Chris Coulter is their number two man in the company. Very well educated, he's got a law degree. And so this was his response when I asked him why the company changed their mind from the 2002 siting. Hopefully it'll take off. Maybe not. Well, can you hand me that binder real quick? I was afraid of this. I think it's important to hear the other side's explanation of why they do things. You won't be able to see the video, but at least you'll be able to hear the audio.
And Chris, in 2002, when you guys applied for the site permit for this whole area, your company promised that they would not accept TSCA-regulated PCBs. Why is that now changing? Why have you changed your mind?
Well, actually, that's not totally true, because actually in our siting, the question was, in 2002, we said we weren't going to take PCBs greater than 50 parts per million. Actually, in our siting application, we said that we were going to take PCBs in accordance with TSCA. on the stand, Ron Edwards, who worked for the company at that time, he's now retired, but he said that we weren't going to be taking PCBs less than 50 parts per million. So there is kind of a contradiction, but in our siting application, we did say that. So I don't know, I mean, it was back in 2002, it's a long time ago, why Ron said what he said, but the point is, in our siting application, we said that we would take PCBs within Tosca.
Okay, so he doesn't know why their vice president in charge of landfill development said what he said. Well, if we look, here is their siting application that he referred to that said that they would be, according to that, they would be working within Tosca. Again, we see in their written application, it says exactly what Ron said. It said they would not accept waste PCBs at concentrations regulated by the Toxic Substance Control Act. So this is what was promised to the county in 2002, which, you know, like I say, the county thought they were getting a municipal waste landfill. So the county gave their conditional approval for siting, and that was based on this public hearing, and it was also based on the written application. So we should be good, right? We've got a promise, we got a local siting saying that, you know, we never have to worry about Tosca regulated PCBs coming into our landfill. We turn the clock forward to 2007, and we find out that our finance committee of the county has been meeting behind closed doors with the landfill, and they've been working out this agreement to bring in this chemical waste landfill. This is the agenda, and these are the meeting minutes that Joe referred to earlier. Now this, the first box there, that was what was the agenda item for that meeting. And then down in the minutes, we read the amendment would support them branching out into rail car service. Something's missing there. Some important piece of information is missing there. So they kept us from the public. Now, to be fair to the landfill, it's not up to the landfill to post the agenda, and it's not up to them to post the minutes. So this falls on the Finance Committee back in 2007. It's my opinion that the Finance Committee intentionally tried to keep this from the public. And so here's our First Amendment to the host agreement, and lo and behold, here is the approval for the chemical waste landfill by the county. And like I say, the people in the county had no prior knowledge of this. This was already voted on and approved on before the public had any idea. And shortly after, a couple months later, Clinton Landfill submitted their application to the US EPA for a TSCA-approved facility to receive the TSCA-regulated PCBs. Now, when the county found out, they were pretty upset. The people felt like they'd been misled. There was two referendums in 2008. The first referendum during the primary was a question whether or not you're in favor of the US EPA approving Clinton Landfill Incorporated application for a chemical waste landfill, and that's still the ongoing application that hasn't been approved yet. That failed by almost 75%. Now, anybody that knows anything about elections, to get people 75% of any vote is incredible. And so the people in the county were very much opposed to this. Now, this had no effect on our local county board. They took no action. They really pretty much ignored it. So another primary was or another referendum was put out there. And this one specifically addressed the county board. It said, shall the DeWitt County Board rescind the amendment that they made with the host agreement? And not only rescind the approval, but then to oppose the construction of this landfill. And that also passed by nearly 75%. Interestingly enough, just prior to that second referendum, the county board came up with the second amendment to the host agreement. Now, they took out the support for the landfill, but this is the interesting paragraph they put in. Basically says, you know, we don't know what's good enough for our own residents, so we're going to leave it up to the Illinois EPA and the US EPA to tell us what's best for our citizens. And you know, that's always a smart move for an elected official to do. So they say that we neither support or oppose this permitting or development or construction of the landfill. And this is the paragraph that's been used on the county board to keep them silent on this issue ever since. And just to kind of show you the mindset that it's caused in our county government, this is a memo that was put out by our current state's attorney, Carl Koretz, to the county board. Now, this was almost a year ago when this came up, and this was in response to an agenda item on the county board agenda, and a gentleman from Watch was going to give a presentation as to why he thought the county needed to ask for a new siting. And so the only information the state's attorney had, the only information the landfill had, was the agenda item. It says Watch organization to give presentation to the board for its consideration of a draft resolution that a siting for Clinton landfill facility is needed. And I don't have the whole response here, but it generated almost a full page of response from our state's attorney. And some of it's really interesting. I'm not doing this to embarrass him, but it does give you a mindset, an idea of the mindset that we're dealing with down there. And he said, maybe you think it's worth it to risk our cash cow to stick it to the landfill. But I repeat that violating our agreement would do nothing to impair the landfill's permit process before the EPA. It would simply take $1.3 million out of our budget. It's all risk and no reward. And then he refers to the letter that the landfill sent to the county board, in which the landfill said, you know, if they adopted a resolution like this, they would consider it as a breach of contract. And the state's attorney goes on and says, I don't have the luxury of being able to have a public opinion, although he states it quite often, on the landfill issues, but it's clear that the landfill is interested in having a positive working relationship with the county. But you better believe they're not going to lose any sleep over keeping the $1.3 million if we violate the host agreement. Then he goes on to say, if I were the attorney for the landfill, I wouldn't care one bit if DeWitt County violated the host agreement. Again, it's because all the host agreement does is to impose obligations on the landfill to the financial gain of the county. So basically he's saying for $1.3 million, it's okay to look the other way. And that's what it comes down to. That's what we've been facing with for 2, 3, 4 years down there, that because of the money that the county gets through their host agreement, that it's okay to look the other way, because anything that we do that would potentially upset the landfill, we risk losing our host fees. Now, one thing that should be mentioned is prior to this, in 2012, going back, the only county in Illinois that had an active chemical waste landfill had no solid waste coordinator. We had they allowed our solid waste plan to expire. We had no local inspection. And so basically they had a hands-off approach to solid waste management in our county. And this is the county with the only active chemical waste landfill in the state. So you can see, you know, how frustrating this has been for the people in the county. You know, when you host any landfill, whether it's municipal or chemical, it comes with a responsibility. And our county, prior to this last year, really didn't take that seriously. Now, as you can see, the current board is trying to take some steps. This is the resolution they just passed in November, where they just basically said that they believe the chemical waste unit requires a new siting. They're not even getting close to opposing the chemical waste unit process with the US EPA. This is strictly an Illinois EPA issue. They're just saying that as part of the process, we think a local siting should have been done. We want every I dotted, every T crossed. That's all they're saying. We want every procedure followed. And as you can see from the vote, it wasn't, you know, a slam dunk. You would think that everybody on that county board would agree with that. Unfortunately, they didn't. You can see the board, there's about a 5-7 to 5 split, Seven approved of it, five didn't. These five tend to vote in the same block on landfill issues. Not making judgments, but you can decide for yourself. I say, currently the landfill's being used. It's in operation. We're not taking in the TSCA-regulated PCBs yet. That can't happen until the US EPA gets involved. But we are bringing in this manufactured gas plant, the MGP waste, which are the old coal tars that are produced from the old coal gasification plants. And this is some pretty nasty stuff. Prior to Clinton Landfill, the Illinois EPA would only allow this stuff to go into hazardous waste landfills. But since the chemical waste unit is built to hazardous waste landfill standards, they allow it to go in here. But it's not a hazardous waste landfill. Okay. If it quacks, if it walks like a duck and talks like a duck. But to give you an idea of maybe some of the things that might come into the landfill, if they would happen to get this US EPA TSCA permit, this is a site up in Summet, Illinois. Summet is on the south side of Chicago. This is a pile of what they call auto shredder residue, ASR. It's the landfill likes to call it shredder fluff. I don't see anything fluffy about it, but it's from grinding up cars. They take the cars and grind them, take them through these huge grinders, spit them out. They separate out the metals that are metallic. The rest of it is shredder residue. Now, this site's been around since the 50s, and over the years, it was victimized by illegal dumping. And so now it's a Superfund site. The owners went bankrupt, and it's been sitting up there. And according to the US EPA, it's full of hazardous substances. It's got PCBs, it's got high concentrations of lead. As we've heard that the TSCA permit is for anything 50 parts per million and greater. We see here that some of this residue tests at 217 parts per million. So that's why this site can't go into Clinton unless we get the TSCA permit. Also interesting connection here with the landfill is the village. And there again, the village has a problem. I wouldn't want this in my backyard. This has been sitting up there. No one seems to know what to do with it. But they've reached an agreement with Peoria Disposal where if they get the task permit, this material would come down to Clinton. And then after they clean up the site, it would become a transfer station. The site happens to sit on the Illinois-Michigan Canal, so they have access to Lake Michigan and the Great Lakes. It's also adjacent to the railroads, and one of the railroads happens to go down to Clinton. So you put the pieces together, and you can see where this would be a great transfer station for all the Great Lakes PCB cleanups that need to be taken care of. And so so the city of Summit has a real interest in Clinton Landfill, and they filed an amicus brief, and that's where this information came from, with the complaint that the coalition had with the Illinois Pollution Control Board. The city of Summit was on the side of the landfill and wanted the case dismissed. And so there's a lot of pieces to this. So that kind of gives you an idea of, just a small idea, how we got to where we're at. Like I say, there's so many twists and turns to the story. It's unbelievable. A lot of it was under the radar. A lot of it I blame on our local government. A lot of it I blame on our state government. It took several parties to make this happen. But what do we do from here on out? We can get involved personally, locally, on a state level, on a federal level. On a personal level, one thing we did in our family, we evaluated who our trash hauler was. We had area disposal for 15 years, and quite honestly, they did a good job and provided good service. But we had a real hard time writing that check to them, knowing that they were trying to put chemical waste over our drinking water. And so we switched trash providers. And so Another thing you could do is letter writing. Letter writing is a great tool. You can write letters to the editor. Those are effective, especially if they're written, you know, logically and clearly. They have a great effect. Writing to your legislators, your local leaders, the state agencies, write to the heads of these state agencies. And we have a list of contacts for this area, I think out by the table, that you can pick up on your way out if you'd like. But write letters, and you know, write those letters and sign your name. The internet, fill out the blank ones, are okay. They're a great way to get a lot of information out in a hurry, but it doesn't hurt to write that letter and sign your name in ink. And as John said, get connected. You know, this effort has had so many different people wanting to get involved, but it's been disconnected. And so right now there's three main groups fighting this. There's WATCH, which is a group that started almost from day one down in DeWitt County. And WATCH stands for We're Against Toxic Chemicals. And it was a small group when it started. And be honest with you, I don't think we'd be sitting here today if it wasn't for that group waving the red flag early on. They were the first ones to make public the host agreement that was approving the landfill. They're the ones that started going to the county board meetings, making noise, getting with state officials, and they also got involved politically in DeWitt County because, like I said, this didn't get as far as it did as quick as they did without a political element involved. And so WATCH is still active down there. They slog it out in the trenches every week. And they catch a lot of heat down in DeWitt County because, unfortunately, there is a minority, a vocal minority, that does want to see this happen. And so, you know, if you want to get involved in the DeWitt County area, WATCH is a good organization. They meet every Sunday night at Hardee's. I don't know about the taillight if they stand next to the taillight, but they meet at Hardee's, and it's quite amusing to watch the opposition circle the building and take pictures and do head counts and things like that because that's what happens. Also the Mahomet Aquifer Protection Alliance is a fairly new organization. We got started to try to give more of a regional message out, and basically, you know, if you're over the aquifer or if you're not, you know, you're invited to join. There again, on the way out on the table, there's a place you can mark or sign up if you want some information on that. The Sierra Club, the Prairie Group, has taken on this year the opposition to the chemical waste landfill. So they're going to be taking an active part in that this year. So if you're already a member of the Sierra Club, or if you want to join, that would be a good organization. On a personal level, the signs have been great. If you drive around DeWitt County and surrounding areas, you'll see these red signs. These have been out here for probably close to 4 or 5 years. And if you've ever had these signs and had to mow around them and had to chase them after windstorms, for these people to still have these signs up in their yard means they're really devoted. And so there were some signs out front. I don't know if they're still there. If not, there's two or three. And if not, just there again, give your name on the way out and we'll make sure you get a sign. But here's a couple of signs that are out there, some of the big banners we've put up in the area. On a local, there again, DeWitt County, we need to work on our state's attorney. We need to get him on board and really start representing the people in this situation. He's got a local siting issue he needs to address. We have a local siting that says, you know, that they can't do this TSCA application, that he needs to tell them to pull their application, quite frankly, until they get a new siting. We have an inspection issue down there, and then we also have, you know, the other issues with the host agreement. Elections, you know, get involved in elections. Find out where your representatives sit on this issue. You know, go out there and ask them the tough questions. Illinois EPA, I don't know, I don't have time to really talk about how many ways the Illinois EPA needs to be revamped, but right now, they're almost autonomous The way they're operating through this permit modification process, they have trampled the Illinois Protection or Environmental Protection Act so poorly, so badly with this local siting issue. They have basically ignored this local siting as far as this chemical waste unit goes. And the idea of being able to subdivide an already sited landfill into these chemical waste units, to me, is quite frightening. You know, if you live in a county with a landfill, and if they get away with this, that they can come into any landfill that's already sited, and then they have the freedom to subdivide your landfill into chemical waste units, quite frankly, that's pretty chilling. And that's not really, we think it's above their authority, but someone needs to call them on it. They need to give better information. What they're sending out to the counties as far as these permit modifications is not nearly enough. We get these notices from every time they do a permit modification. Sometimes it's minor, sometimes it's major. You know, we found out that they started letting them take asbestos into our landfill. Well, if you look at our 2002 siting, the 2002 siting says they can't bring in asbestos. So there again, here's another example of the state permitting something that the local siting doesn't allow. So somehow we need to get that connected. Somehow the communication needs to take place. And there again, they don't have any quality of life considerations in their decisions. It's purely technical. So, you know, Illinois EPA, we need to get the protection back into EPA. You know, it's not the everything is permitted agency. It's the, you know, they're supposed to be, first and foremost, they're supposed to be protecting the public. And unfortunately, they've gotten away from that. So, you know, we need to put pressure on the legislators to get, you know, the Illinois EPA back in line and responsible for the people. You know, I'll just leave it at that because, like I say, there's so many things with testing and things at the Illinois EPA. And with the working group, you know, hopefully that's going to start shining a light on that. You know, we've got the elections coming up. You know, check and see how they fall on this. The governor's election, you know, find out what the governor's opinion on. He's been pretty quiet on this situation. And the federal, there again, we've been talking about this TSCA permit. It's still outstanding. The fact that it was in draft approval back in 2010 and hasn't been approved is a good thing, but we need to make sure it just doesn't happen. The sole source we've already talked about, and there's a website you can go there. That's going to be very important for the future. And there again, you know, let's put pressure on our legislators. So that's basically all I have to say. You know, I think back in 2009, we had the US EPA come down and give a presentation to the county board. And someone asked the US EPA, said, what would happen if the aquifer became contaminated? And the guy said, well, you know, he said, we'd bring it down to bottled water. And you know, and he was kind of glib about it, and everybody kind of chuckled a little bit. But you know, this was West Virginia. And you know, when I saw this and you see people standing in line with jugs and plastic totes and anything they can get to get water out of a tanker truck, you know, when I saw this, it put a chill down my spine because, you know, that is the reality. You know, you may joke about having to bring bottled water down, but that could be a reality. And so we need to stop it now. You know, once it's permitted, it's going to be terribly hard to unpermit. So we need to stop the federal permit now, make sure that never happens. And then we need to get to working on the state, Illinois EPA, and start undoing some of this hazardous waste that's going in there currently. And so, you know, get involved, get connected. Don't give up. This is not going to go away anytime soon. But just stay in there, and I think the generations to come will appreciate it. So thank you.
Okay, hello everyone. Caparella, and my paying job is as a professor at ISU, and I see we've run a little over time, so I'll have to go against my professorial DNA and be brief. To that end, I won't be showing a PowerPoint, which is also against my professorial DNA, but I'll live with that. So what I wanted to do was just focus on a few concluding thoughts. First, on some of the lessons I think we've learned, certainly I've learned today. And then take a very brief overview of some short-term and long-term actions that we can be taking on this specific issue. In terms of lessons learned, I hope everyone sees that the counterpoint to the Iron Triangle that Bruce and John talked about, and that has great currency, the counterpoint to those moneyed interests, to those people, as Mayor Girard mentioned, that meet in chambers to discuss commerce. The counterpoint to that is citizen action. And citizens, really, you have a lot more power than you think. I used to not believe that. I'd hear professors tell me that. But having actually tried it and engaged in it, on a lot of issues, it's amazing how little it takes. I've actually been told by other politicians and by regulators that they need a counterpoint to all the pressure they're getting from the moneyed interests. And it doesn't take a lot, really, to give them that coverage that they need to do the right thing. A lot of them actually do want to do the right thing. But if you don't come out and tell them what you think the right thing is and why, then they really, I can understand, are going to get rolled over by the muddied interests. So you've got to stay engaged with all of the, both the local political folks as well as the people who are regulators. And you'll find that they're more on your side than you think, but they need the support. So while we are quick to castigate, we also have to be very important to thank and support local politicians and regulators who are willing to do the right thing. So that's one lesson to learn. Groups such as Watch that really started this process, they got me involved in my non-paying job of being conservation chair and unfortunately too often in the entire committee of the local Audubon Society. And that's how I've been following the issue. In fact, Audubon submitted comments back in 2011 to US EPA when we heard there was a public comment period open on this particular issue. Again, though, I suspect very few comments were coming back then, but thankfully the diligence of Watch and others, it was really citizens that got the attention of our leaders, the politicians and the regulators that were really concerned. So don't underestimate your capability, just be sure you do it strategically and in a focused manner. It's very important to stay educated, and one thing we're going to have to figure out is how to keep everyone in line with this complicated issue. I hope that MAPA's website may be the organizing force so that we don't have that other hodgepodge of triangles that John talked about where everybody's going different directions. I think MAPA needs to do a little bit more aggressive job in making that a workable website, but I hope that will be a website along with Champaign County to keep us all informed so that we can get our marching orders as to what our citizens can do effectively. So I'm really hoping that'll happen. Another lesson that was quite powerful here is the need for proactive approaches to these kinds of issues. I've been involved in doing things locally for about 20 years and frankly sometimes get tired of being a lone voice trying to get people aware, and people just don't get involved until things are really so far along that it's an incredibly uphill climb. You know, you've probably heard the legend of Sisyphus. Well, you know, I feel like so often that's the case, and it's, to be frankly, a lot of times our own fault. We need to be more proactive in thinking about making this something that should have been nipped in the bud. As Dr. Wehrman said, sole source aquifer. If we had done that years ago, we wouldn't be here today. It would already have been nipped in the bud. So we're fighting a rear guard action all the time. So one lesson to be learned is we've got to quit doing that. We have to have citizens stay engaged in environmental issues and support our local groups like chapters of Sierra Club or chapters of Audubon or Watch or MAPA. You've got to, you can't just briefly fly in on these issues and then leave. You've got to know what's going on. And unfortunately, because of a lot of the changes in media these days, it's very hard. It's a challenge to keep informed, and I certainly empathize with that. Those of you who work a full-time job like I do, you know you have limited time. That's why I treasure the retirees who are putting their time into this. I really appreciate that. Your time is incredibly well spent to help those of us who have full-time jobs maximize what we're doing. Another lesson to be learned is we've got to have intergovernmental action and cooperation. This fragmented way which we are approaching natural resource uses such as water, as Mayor Pressing talked about, is going to kill us. We're going to be losing because we're too divided. You know, you've got one group that comes up to fight one local water issue, another to fight another. And they're not looking at the big picture. As someone who teaches conservation biology and environmental issues at ISU, I'm always telling the students that you've got to be in the trenches, but you don't want to lose sight of the big picture, the eyes on the prize, as Dr. Martin Luther King used to talk about. So you've really got to do that. And believe it or not, You can do that as a citizen. You don't have to understand all the mumbo-jumbo of us biology professors or the engineers or anything. A lot of this is darn common sense. You don't crap in your water supply. It's probably something we learned as humans way back when in our evolutionary history. There's a lot of very commonsensical understandings. You don't need to get lost in the detail. But we really do have to leverage intergovernmental action. This can't be done alone by citizens groups. As we saw, this is why the coalition that's been put together is fantastic. But we need a lot more intergovernmental action, particularly when it comes to water issues. So how many people are aware of MAC, the Mahomet Aquifer Consortium? Probably not many. I will ask you to go to their Mahomet Aquifer Consortium website. I will ask you, particularly officials, but everybody, to read this 2009 report, A Plan to Improve the Planning and Management of Water Supplies in East Central Illinois, which focuses particularly on the Mahomet Aquifer, which is seen as the Holy Grail for all of us. Whether it can be the Holy Grail for all of us if we, one, do not take care of it, and two, do not understand how to use it sustainably is an open question. But I really think everyone should read this. It is written in a very good way that anyone can understand, and it shows kind of the context in which we're concerned about the Mahomet Aquifer, because it's really, we're concerned about the Mahomet Aquifer as one of many parts of the East Central Illinois water supply. If you are fairly immune to both hernias and brain freeze, you could actually download something like this. This is actually a water demand scenario for East Central Illinois, 2005 to 2050. It's quite enlightening if you want to get in that level of the weeds, but if not, read the report. We really are on the cusp of some serious problems in the future if we do not take an intergovernmental approach. And one of the big pushes is that since 2009, if not before, we've got to have a regional planning approach. Even Texas will do that. We know what Texans are like, right? I can say that. I went to school in Texas. But if they can do it, we can do it. If they can pull themselves together, we can. But we have it. We've got a regional plan in paper, and nobody's moving to get it done. Again, this would not be the Sisyphean fight that we have today if we already had a regional plan that everybody had bought into and were pursuing. So I really worry that, you know, if we may win this battle and lose the war, because the bigger war is going to keep coming, and this is just one facet of a bigger issue. Dr. Wehrman, I was very glad, gave a broader context showing how the Mahomet Aquifer is interconnected with our surface waters, whether reservoirs or free-flowing streams, and that really what this is a component of our overall water issue. I mention that because he was talking about the whole justification for sole source aquifer is that we don't have capacity in our existing reservoirs to accommodate people who will be depending on the aquifer if the aquifer gets contaminated. Well, guess what? There's a flip side to that. The aquifer is not going to help us if we do not pay attention to our current reservoirs. There are threats to those reservoirs going completely unaddressed. Anybody heard of the Enbridge pipeline bringing diluted bitumen from the tar sands of Alberta, Canada, becoming through next year because nobody has been willing to stand up and fight it? Audubon tried and failed. Guess what? It's going to be crossing Buck Creek, and a leak there of the type that happened in Michigan would contaminate forever, or at least for a very long time period, a water source of Bloomington, which is the Mackinac pumping pool. Nobody advocated to put in the safeguards that could have been put in. The next crossing, Money Creek, upstream from Lake Bloomington, an equivalent leak like we've seen from Enbridge pipelines elsewhere, and you can write off Lake Bloomington as a water supply. Again, why did nobody push to make that safeguards there? The city of Bloomington signed off on this in the previous administration, said, oh, fine, go ahead, Enbridge, do what you're going to do. Well, we lose these kind of water supplies on the surface, and everybody's flocking to the Mahomet Aquifer, not a good thing. We've got to recognize that while we don't want to be too diffuse in our efforts, this is really all part of one big picture, and that Enbridge pipeline is the one elephant in the room that nobody seems to want to talk about. I'm glad we're doing PCBs, but that is not the whole thing. So we've got to have this contextual overview at the same time that we get very pragmatic and in the trenches in fighting the PCBs. So how do we fight the PCB issue as well as these other issues? One, we've got to stay informed and stay educated, which is why I hope the MAPA website and others will be able to do that. You've got to somehow keep up with all of this stuff, and I can tell you it is hard to do, those of you who work full-time jobs or have very busy families, but you know, it doesn't take a lot to really, again, get to the basic understanding of these issues. You definitely want to write your politicians, local, state, federal. You want to write your regulators. I hope everybody did pick up the handout from the Mahomet Aquifer Protection Coalition showing some of the places to write. I'm sure they will put on their website other places to write. You don't have to write a treatise on why the particular bedrock and other things is not adequate, et cetera. You just have to write and say, this is not going to protect my water. I'm very disappointed about this. You've got to regulate and protect our water. So you don't have to go on and on. You just have to express your well-reasoned and presented thoughts on this. So write everyone. As Steve said, find out who of your local and state politicians support dealing with this. I was very happy that Senator Rose, who we don't share a lot with commonality politically, I'm totally behind him on this and very congratulatory that he's moving forward with their working group. You've got to support these politicians, know how they stand, and insist those who aren't being active in this fight to get active. So in the short term, it's going to be an uphill battle with this, but I think that a lot of the forces are being marshaled where you as citizens can really have an impact. Don't underestimate the impact of written letters. And I emphasize that versus postcards and emails, which are fine, but your handwritten, heartfelt letters really carry a lot of weight. Those are short-term things. Long-term, what are we supposed to do? Well, we heard from Dr. Wehrman that long-term, we need to be supporting the sole source aquifer designation. That means keep an eye out for when the public hearings are coming about. Go to that online petition, put your name up front, your John Hancock on that petition. You want to file comments in relation to the sole source aquifer. It won't solve the PCB problem, but it will certainly help us in future fights, which I know we will be having. So you definitely want to do that long term. And so I did learn about that, which is very good. Sole source aquifer, stay in on that one as well. And I also heard something very interesting that I was very sad that Representative Brady did not address, but maybe we need to kind of encourage him to address it, which is that we probably need to strengthen our landfill regulations. and that really needs to be a long-term thought. So you might want to drop Representative Brady a line, thank him for coming here, and say, you know, there's something you can do, which is sponsor the bill that will improve the regulation of landfills so that these kinds of weak siting reviews are a thing of the past. So I think we learned a lot as to what we can do in term, both short-term and long-term, and I hope you do take to heart the broader contextual issue of this is water, water, water. The projections show us as being a water-stressed region in the future. That future may come sooner depending on just how well we handle the Enbridge pipeline, how well we handle the PCB threat, and then future threats that we know are coming down the pike. So I would encourage you to do so. Join your local organizations like Audubon. Contact me anytime you want to. I'm a professor at ISU in the biology department. I'm also on the John Wesley Powell Audubon Society. Any and all issues I'm always happy to hear about and will offer my thoughts on how you can effectively be active or how I can perhaps help you be active. But we really are all in this together, and do not underestimate your power. The power of the people is truly real, to kind of harken back to the Vietnam days. But I was skeptical myself, but I've actually seen some major wins over the past 20 years just because some people got together and tried to leverage doing things. This is a big one, though. We've got to have the politicians and the regulators on our side. So this is going to take more than what's usual, but I see a lot of great willing hands and minds out there. You all know what to do, so let's do it. Thank you.
Well, just some great ideas there. Mark Peterson's going to come up and just make a few closing comments. But thanks to all of you for your time today. Just a lot of good information shared, these ideas, some terrific ideas. I think the important thing is, you know, what can we actually do? Okay, we spend a day talking about it. Now it's time to do something about it. Hopefully the officials will carry on, and those of us who were retired and just good citizens, hopefully will play a part too. Mark Peterson has just been a terrific help in putting this on. Of course, I've worked with Mark while city manager in Champaign, and Mark is just one of the top city managers in the country, let's face it. So Mark.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Well, if you're not totally pissed off by now, you're comatose, because I'm mad. And I've learned some things today that I didn't know before, and I'm serious. I'm angry about this, and you should be angry. I don't have a PowerPoint presentation, but I do have something to show you. This is what we're talking about right here. Glass of water. Simple glass of water. It's beautiful, isn't it? It's Mahomet Aquifer water. We take it for granted. We shouldn't. You know, it takes, the human body can survive maybe 3 to 5 days without water. It's essential to life, it's essential to society. We're blessed with a priceless water supply. That Mahomet Aquifer is more valuable than the most productive oil field in Saudi Arabia. It's priceless. I think it was the late Paul Simon, our former U.S. Senator, who said that, God forbid, the next world war will not be fought over racial conflict or military aggression, religious beliefs. It'll be fought over drinking water. Let's hope not, but it's that precious, and we are so lucky in this region to have such a fabulous water supply. We're very lucky, and I don't think we really realize that, and maybe now we're starting to with the threat that's occurred, that is occurring. So I wanna just mention a couple of things. We invited to this meeting today a number of elected officials. And I'm proud to say a lot were here, a lot of local elected officials. Certainly the municipal and county governments are doing what they can on the legal front. Joe Hooker did a great job of kind of capsulizing what we're doing, and unfortunately we're not winning that battle. We're not giving up, but we're not winning. And I'm concerned that we won't win. I'm worried that we won't win. You know, what's the old line from Watergate? Follow the money. There's a lot of money involved here, folks. We just read about somebody won the Mega Lotto a couple days ago. The Coulter family, they don't play the Mega Lotto because they've got their, this is their Mega Lotto ticket, and it's already good. And this is a picture of Clinton, the landfill. Millions, hundreds of millions of dollars they're going to make off this. And in doing so, they're playing Russian roulette with the future of this region. And that should make everybody angry, very angry. The political fix is in, clearly. And it's going to take a monumental effort to get this thing turned around. It's going to take a monumental effort to get the US EPA to deny the application for PCBs, and it's gonna take an even more monumental effort to stop what is already taking place, and there's already chemical waste going in that landfill, and once it's there, it's not coming out. It's not coming out, ever. So we did have some elected officials here, but I think that the story is really more important, who wasn't here. None of our congressional representatives were here. Rodney Davis sent a staff member. That was nice. We only had 2 state representatives that showed up. Dan Brady, fortunately, his office is right across the street, so it was convenient for him. And I'm glad he was here, and I'm glad he stayed. And Mike Frericks. Nobody else showed up. That makes me very nervous. The people that are specifically responsible for overseeing the agencies who are letting us down don't seem to be engaged, and that is a problem. Where's Governor Quinn? Arguably the most environmentally conscientious governor in Illinois' history, and he is silent. Governor Quinn ought to be having a press conference every week on this issue, but he hasn't said a word. He's not taken, to the best of my knowledge, a position. The Illinois Environmental Protection Agency is his agency. It's his job to oversee it, yet he doesn't seem to be engaged at all in this issue. That doesn't make sense. Something's wrong. Why not? Mayor Coos, our mayor who was had to leave, he ran into Governor Quinn this last week. He was at Illinois State University, and he pulled him aside and said, hey, what do you know about the Clinton landfill situation? Well, he said, I've heard something about it. Tell me. And he made a few notes. What? He doesn't know about it? Are you kidding me? That's scary. Dick Durbin, our United States Senator, and Mark Kirk, our other United States Senator, they've indicated they're supportive. And there's a letter on a board out in the hallway. You can see a copy of a letter that they signed. And they sent it to the US EPA regional director. And it said they're concerned. They're concerned about this application for a PCB landfill. They're concerned. It's a nice, polite letter. What that letter needed to say is, what the hell are you people thinking at the EPA? I mean, I'm serious. What is going on? Our congressional delegation, certainly the three that represent Central Illinois, where we're most affected, and that's Aaron Schock, Rodney Davis, and John Shimkus, ought to be, along with Senators Durbin and Kirk, ought to be throwing a temper tantrum at the office of the EPA in Washington, D.C. I think Dick Durbin needs to call a press conference on the steps of the Capitol, invite the entire delegation to say, we are not going to let what happened in West Virginia happen in Central Illinois. It is not going to happen on our watch. So it's up to you, and I think Angelo said it well. It is up to all of you. We're doing what we can on the municipal and county level, and frankly, we need to do more, and I think we will. But I think it's going to take people in this room expressing your outrage. We don't need polite letters saying we're concerned. We need outrage. And our elected leaders in Springfield and in Washington, D.C. need to know that you are angry and that you're demanding action now. We don't have time. We're running out of time. That landfill is taking in chemical waste as we speak. This is urgent. So you need to go home right now. When you're angry, this is the time to do it. Don't wait like Joe Hooker, where he calm himself down. You know, think about Joe's comments again and go home and get on your computer or write a letter and say, we need to do something and we need to do it now, Mr. Representative or Mr. Senator, now. And they're the only ones, I mean, it's their agencies. My gosh, these are the people that control the US EPA and the Illinois EPA, purportedly. So they need to take action. This needs to be priority number one. Dan Brady, this needs to be his number one priority. We talk about, you know, the economy and creating jobs and reining in public pensions and minimum wage and all these important issues, but this issue has got to be number one right now. It is critical. The future of our region is at stake. And these people at the Clinton landfill, the Coulter family, are playing Russian roulette with your future. And it's shameful. It's crazy. And I don't know how else to express other than it's outrageous. And we all need to do something about it. It's everyone's problem. We can't sit around and wait for the McLean County Board or the Champaign County Board or the Clinton City Council. We've got to take this bull by the horns and do something ourselves right now. All of you have to take ownership and tell your friends. You know, I think Mayor Girard said, tell 10 people. And I think these expressions of sincere outrage will get somebody's attention. I hope it needs to. The stuff I've heard today is unbelievable. How could this happen in this country? It's like right out of a bad made-for-TV movie. You know, it's crazy. But when you put together powerful political forces with outrageous amounts of money, things like this can happen, I guess, even in this country. So we've got to push back as hard as we can, and I want to thank you all for coming. I want to thank the presenters. Wow, what some great information that we received today. I think we all learned a lot. And I also want to shout out to those folks that watch. That's the little engine that could. If it wasn't for them, where are you? Raise your hand if you're here, if you're watching. I'm Dave. Raise your hand. Thank you. You know, I'll acknowledge the town of Normal, and Steve has said, the city of Champaign, and all. We're Johnny Come Latelys. We came to the table too late. We wish we'd have been here early. We're here now. But if it wasn't for Watch, we'd be really in bad shape. We've still got a chance. I think we've got a good, strong fighting chance. It's an uphill battle, but I think we've got a chance, and that's because of the folks at Watch. They gave us that chance. So thank you for what you've done and what you continue to do every day. We really sincerely owe you a lot. Okay, go get them. Thank you. I will say we're going to have this whole meeting posted on our website, this recording, and we're going to have the PowerPoints also on our website, and we're going to offer it to anyone else who has a website that wants to post this information. So